Israel, this your brother K. Judah, giving all praise to the Most High Yah in faith in Jesus Christ. And to my Israelite family worldwide, I say peace and blessings. The title of my podcast today is The Kingdom of Christ and Kingdom of God are different. The Kingdom of Christ and Kingdom of God are different. In Christ's kingdom, there will still be flesh and blood and spirit beings on the earth. But on the eighth day, which represent the Father's kingdom, will be nothing but spirit beings. That's that new Jerusalem coming down out of heaven. So get you a Bible. Get you some pen and paper. Write these scriptures down, Israel, and let's study to show yourself approved. Let's deal with it.
Lift your eyes, oh eyes, oh eyes, oh eyes up, and see our tomorrow. We got hope for tomorrow.
Stand up, stand on the hopeless threat. Stand for the not free yet.
When we become one fam, one unit, we make an impact that they won't forget. But we must be one. Yeah, we must be one. Let us stop this pain. Yeah, we must be. Feel your heartbeat, then you play your drama. Cause all around the world there is tragedy. We believe. So rise, oh rise, oh rise, oh rise, oh rise up. Lift your eyes, oh eyes, oh eyes, oh eyes up. And listen to the music. All we got is music.
Stand up, stand for the peace we chase. Stand for the earth we shake.
One body, one people, one mind, yeah. We can make an impact that they won't forget. But we must be.
Thank you.
Hey, Israel, the first thing we're going to do is go to the book of Genesis. Because we must first go to the beginning to get understanding, because God had plans for man. And we need to see what it was. Let's go to the book of Genesis, chapter 1. The book of Genesis, chapter 1. What was God trying to do in the beginning when he created Adam? What was God trying to do in the beginning when he created Adam? This is the book of Genesis, chapter 1. The book of Genesis, chapter 1. And we're going to pick it up at verse 1. Then we're going to skip down. Because I am not dealing with the creation. I am dealing with the two kingdoms. The kingdom of Christ and the kingdom of God, which is the Father's kingdom. And we're going to get understanding today together. So this is Genesis chapter 1. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. And it reads, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." Okay, we understand that all things was created by Christ and for Christ, according to Hebrews chapter 1. Jump down to verse 26. Verse 26, and it reads, "And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. First thing you must understand that a lot of people get confused on. When you read Genesis chapter 1, it's a blueprint. God did not bring Adam to pass until Genesis chapter 2 verse 7. So the whole Genesis chapter 1 is a print. Jump down to verse 31. Verse 31, and it reads, "And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day." Now let's go to Genesis chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 2. This is Genesis chapter 2. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 2. And it reads, "And on the seventh day, God ended his works, which he had made. And he rested on the seventh day from all his works, which he had made." How was God able to rest from all his works when he didn't bring Adam to pass yet? Because it was a blueprint, Israel. And that's what you must understand. The Bible do not contradict itself. I'm going to say that again. The Bible do not contradict itself. It's just that people don't have no understanding. Verse 3. "And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his works, which God created and made." So y'all must understand this also. The seventh day is the only day that God gave a name to. And he sanctified it, meaning set it apart. So y'all going to church on Sunday is not the day of rest. The seventh day of the week is the Sabbath of rest, which we call Saturday. Sunday is the first day of the week. Saturday is the seventh day of the week. Get you some understanding, Israel. Verse 4. "These are the generations of the heavens and of the earth when they were created, in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens." Now jump down to verse 7. Verse 7, and it reads, "And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul." Israel, you are the soul. There's no soul inside of you. If I put a pillow over your face, what you gonna become? A dead soul. But if God breathed life into your nostrils, what you gonna become? A living soul. You are the soul. Jump down to verse 9. Verse 9, and it reads, "And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight, and good for food, the tree of life, also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil." And y'all must understand this also, that the tree of life was Jesus Christ. And the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was Satan the devil. Satan was in the garden. Christ was in the garden. Jump down to verse 16. Verse 16. And it reads, "And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and of evil thou should not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die." Why did God tell Adam, in the day that you eat thereof, you shall surely die? But Adam did not die that same day. We got to get understanding of this. Let's go to 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter, and we coming right back. Hold your marker in Genesis. We coming right back. 2 Peter chapter 3. The book of 2 Peter, chapter 3. 2 Peter, chapter 3, and verse 8. 2 Peter, chapter 3, and verse 8. Yoshua, I see you in the building, brother. How you doing? 2 Peter, chapter 3 and verse 8. This is why God told Adam, in the day that you eat thereof, you shall surely die. But those of us who have understanding, we know Adam did not die that same day that he ate of the tree of the knowledge and good and evil. So why did God tell him, in that day you shall surely die? Let's see. This is 2 Peter chapter 3, and I'm going to pick it up at verse 8. Hold your marker in the book of Genesis, because we're coming right back. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 8, and it reads, "But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as a thousand years, and a thousand years as one day." So that's why the Lord took, go back to the book of Genesis now. That's why the Lord told Adam, in the day that you eat thereof, thou shalt surely die. Because we just read in 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 8. That one day with the Lord is as a thousand years, and a thousand years as one day. So let's go back to Genesis. Back to the book of Genesis. But this time, we're going to go to Genesis chapter 5. Why did the Lord tell Adam that in the day that you eat thereof, you shall surely die? And we just read that a thousand years is as one day, and one day is as a thousand years. Let's go to Genesis chapter 5. The book of Genesis chapter 5. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 5. That's why I say, Israel, precept must be upon precept. Line must be upon line. Here a little and there a little. That's the only way you're going to get understanding of this Bible. This is the book of Genesis, chapter 5, verse 5. Now, remember that a thousand years is as one day, and one day is a thousand years. Let's see what God meant by that. Let's see, what did the Lord mean by that? This is the book of Genesis, chapter 5, and verse 5. And it reads, "And all the days that Adam lived were 930 years, and he died." Now jump down to verse 8. Verse 8, and it reads, "And all the days of Seth were 912 years, and he died." Jump down to verse 11. Verse 11. Jump down to verse 11, and it reads, "And all the days of Enos were 905 years, and he died." I hope you're getting the picture, Israel. Verse 14. "And all the days of Canaan were 910 years, and he died." Jump down to verse 20. Verse 20. "And all the days of Jared were 962 years, and he died." Jump down to verse 27, and it reads, "All the days of Methuselah were and 69 years, and he died. Do y'all get it? No man ever lived to be 1,000 years. Say that again, K. Judah. I just read that all our forefathers made it to 900 plus years, but no man ever lived to be 1,000 years. And that's why the Lord told Adam, in the day that you eat thereof, you shall surely die. None of our fathers lived past 900 years. Because one day is as 1,000 years to the Lord, and 1,000 years as one day. Krista, I see you in the building. My sister Krista is in the building. And I pray for your family, Krista. And I pray all is well with them. In the name of the Most High Yah and his son Christ the Messiah. Now let's go to Genesis chapter 2 again. So I hope y'all understood that all our fathers lived to be 900 plus years, but they never made it past 900 plus years, meaning nobody ever lived to be 1,000 years. So that's why the Lord told Adam, in the day that you eat thereof, you shall surely die. So let's go to Genesis chapter 2 again, and I'm going to pick it up at verse 17. Genesis chapter 2, and I'm going to pick it up at verse 17, and it reads, "But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou should not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die." But we understand now, I went through all that to show you that Adam did not die that same day, but because God let him know, in the day that you eat thereof, you shall surely die. No man ever lived to be 1,000 years. Now let's go to Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3. Because Adam and Eve did something that they had no more access to the tree of life. Let's see what it was. This is the book of Genesis chapter 3. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. And it reads, "Now the serpent was more subtile than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, have God said, ye should not eat of the tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, ye should not eat of it, neither should ye touch it, lest she die." Verse 4. And Satan said unto the woman, "Ye should not surely die." The first lie. The first lie. Verse 5. "For God do know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be open, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil." Now jump down. Jump down to verse 7. Verse 7. And it reads, "And the eyes of them both open, and they knew that they was naked." Now, who y'all think told them that they was naked? Okay, y'all got the picture. Satan told them they was naked. I guarantee you, he told them what them body parts was for also. That's why they was ashamed. Because they knew they was naked. That's why God say, "Who told you? You cannot eat an apple, Israel, and it make you have knowledge." So they was conversating. She was conversating with Satan the devil. They was conversating or conversing one with another. Conversing. Understand that. You cannot eat a fruit and it give you some knowledge. Let me read verse 7 again. "And the eyes of them both were open, and they knew that they was naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves apron." Jump down to verse 9. Jump down to verse 9. And it reads, "And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou?" Why God didn't call Eve? Why God did not call Eve, since the man always want to blame the woman? See, y'all must understand something. Eve was nowhere wrong when God gave Adam those commandments. And say it again, K. Judah. Eve was nowhere wrong when God gave Adam those commandments. So he called Adam, because Adam was the one God gave the commandments to, and he supposed to taught Eve, because Adam is Eve's head covering. That's why when he saw her talking to that serpent, he should have went and grabbed his wife. But he did not. He also ate of the conversation. Read verse 9 again, K. Judah. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, who told thee? Read it again, K. Judah. Who told thee? Meaning somebody had to tell them that they was naked. So all you preachers teaching in church, talking about Eve ate an apple, get you some knowledge. You cannot eat an apple and it give you an epiphany. Verse 11 again. And he said, who told thee that thou was naked? Has thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat? Yes, they ate of the tree that God commanded them not to eat. Now jump down. Jump down to verse 12. Verse 12. And it reads, and the man said, the woman whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. He threw Eve right under the bus. A lot of things that the black man do. I always want to throw the black woman under the bus. No different than the day. Jump down to verse 17. Verse 17. And it reads, and unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and has eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou should not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow should thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Thorns also and thistles should it bring forth to thee, and thou should eat the herbs of the field. Now you have to work hard. All Adam had to do was keep God's commandments. He had an easy job. But since he sinned against God, now he must work in the sweat of his face and eat bread. Verse 19, in the sweat of thy face should thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground, for out of it wast thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust should thou return. No man go to heaven when they die. Dust you art, dust you shall return. That's another thing y'all teach in church, that when somebody die, they go to heaven. You do not go to heaven when you die. You can't show me nowhere in this Bible where Christ said he was going to take you to heaven when you die. You rest in the grave until the first resurrection. Understand that, Israel. Now jump down to verse 22. Because Adam took some away from us. He took some away from us when he sinned against God. Let's see what it is. I'd rather let the Bible talk to you, Israel. I'd rather let God break this word down for you. I don't have no private interpretation. I let God's word break itself down. I just read it. Verse 22. And it reads, and the Lord God said, behold, the man is become as one of us, to know good and evil. And now, lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life. Who is the tree of life? Christ. The Lord God sent him forth from the garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. I need to read verse 22 again. Because y'all must understand, lest he put forth his hand and do what, K. Judah? Listen to Christ's conversation and figure out how to live forever. Let me read 22 again. And the Lord God said, behold, the man is become as one of us, to know good and evil. And now, lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. Let's see, hear our conversation and figure out how to live forever. What did Christ do? Verse 23. Therefore, the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. Do y'all hear that? He had to send this man out of the garden from whence he was taken. Verse 24. So he drove out the man and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life. No, to keep the way of the Garden of Eden. To keep the way of the tree of life. Do y'all understand that? So those cherubims, angels, which also Satan is a cherubim angel. A lot of people don't even know that. Satan is a cherubim angel. Cherubim angels have four faces. You can go read it on your own, the book of Ezekiel chapter 1, and it will tell you that cherubim angels have four faces, six wings, eyes all over their bodies, and they have calves' feet. Understand that. That is Satan the devil. He do not have horns on his head like how they put in these movies. Satan is a cherubim angel with four faces, six wings, and eyes all over his body. That's Satan the devil. Understand that, Israel. Okay, let's go to Psalm 69. Because Adam took access to the tree of life. He took access to the tree of life. But somebody gave it back to us, and let's see who it is. Psalm 69. The book of Psalms. 69. So y'all must understand this. When Adam sinned against God, that was it. We had no more access to the tree of life. We all was doomed to hell. But somebody restored that which he took not away. Let's see who it is. This is Psalm 69. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 4. Psalm 69. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 4. If Christ would have never died for our sins, we was all doomed to hell. But he did something. And let's read Psalm 69, verse 4. And it reads, "They that hate me without a cause are more than the hairs of my head. They that would destroy me, being my enemies wrongfully." Why? Because Christ never committed sin. So they hated him wrongfully, "are mighty than I." Did y'all hear that? Christ say, "They that hate me without a cause are more than the hairs of my head. They that would destroy me, being my enemies wrongfully, are mighty. Then I restored that which I took not away." Read it again, K. Judah. "Then I restored that which I took not away." Read it again, K. Judah. "Then I restored that which I took not away." What did Christ restore that he took not away? Because he didn't take anything away from us. Why? Because he never committed sin. But Adam took some away from us, which was what? Access to the tree of life. But Christ say, "I restored it." Let's see how. Let's go to 1 John chapter 2. Y'all see what I'm doing? Precept on precept, Israel. I let the Bible talk that talk. I let the Bible walk that walk. Let's go to 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. And I'm going to pick up, I'm going to read one verse, verse 25. 1 John chapter 2. And I'm going to read verse 25. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 25. I'm trying to wait till you get there, Israel. 1 John chapter 2. And I'm going to read one verse, verse 25. And it reads, "And this is the promise that he had promised us, even eternal life." Oh, so when I read in Psalm 69, verse 4, when Christ say, "I restored that which I took not away," what was that, Israel? Access back to eternal life. Let me read 25 again. "And this is the promise that he had promised us, even eternal life." That's what Christ restored that he took not away. Your access back to eternal life. Now let's go to Daniel chapter 7. Because Christ died for our sins and made the atonement with his blood, what did the Father give him? Let's see. Let's go to the book of Daniel chapter 7. The book of Daniel chapter 7. This is the book of Daniel chapter 7. I guarantee you, Israel, if you study this Bible and do precept on precept and ask God for wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, this Bible is easy to be understood. That's why the Bible said the simplicity of Christ. Simple, easy to be understood. You just have to read it. Something that our people struggle with. We don't like to read. You must study this Bible to get understanding. Because you never know when you might run into somebody and they think they understand the Bible, and they saying things that they can't find in the Bible. That's when you come and you let this Bible do what it do. This is Daniel chapter 7. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 13. After Christ died for our sins and gave us the promise of eternal life, what did the Father give him? Let's see, Israel. The book of Daniel chapter 7 and verse 13. And it reads, I saw in the night vision, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. So they brought Christ to the Most High Yah. And let's see what he said. Verse 14. And there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which should not pass away, and his kingdom which should not be destroyed. So that's what the Father gave Christ, a kingdom. But where's this kingdom going to be at? Let's go to Psalms 132. Where's this kingdom going to be at? Is it going to be in heaven or on the earth? I'm going to let the Bible tell you. Let's go to Psalms 132. Psalms 132. The book of Psalms, chapter 132. Because a lot of people believe they're going to be raptured off to heaven. Let's see what Christ's kingdom going to be at. This is Psalms 132. The book of Psalms 132. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 13. The book of Psalms chapter 132. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 13. And it reads, For the Lord hath chosen Zion. Read it again, K. Judah. For the Lord have chosen Zion. He have desired it for his habitation. What is habitation? Where you live at. So Christ trying to come out of heaven. You trying to go to heaven. Christ want to rule on the earth. You trying to go to heaven. Verse 14. This is my rest forever. Read it again, K. Judah. This is my rest forever. Here will I dwell, for I have desired it. Where Christ say he want to dwell in Zion. He say he have desired it. So why are you trying to go to heaven and Christ trying to come down from heaven? Let's go to Luke chapter 1. Christ say he want to dwell in Zion. Let's go to Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 31. Luke chapter 1 and verse 31. Christ is trying to dwell on the earth, Israel. Christ do not want to stay in heaven. Even the Father don't want to stay in heaven. That's why they have the 8th day. But that's kind of deep. So I'm going to just stay on this lesson. That's another lesson. If you get understanding of the feast days of the Lord, then you understand all of God's plans. I'm going to say it again. If you understand the feast days that are contained in Leviticus chapter 23, this is Luke chapter 1 and verse 31. Now, we just read in the book of Psalms that Christ say he want to dwell in Zion. Let's see. Luke chapter 1, verse 31. And it reads, And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus. And he shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. Where's David's throne at, Israel? In Jerusalem, in Zion. Verse 33, And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. The Bible just told you, Israel, that Christ would sit upon David's throne. Where's David's throne? In Zion. So where's Christ going to be at? On the earth. In Jerusalem, not in heaven. Now let's go to John chapter 6. John chapter 6. Because before Christ ruled this earth, he going to do something. Let's see what it is. John chapter 6. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 39. John chapter 6. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 39. before Christ ruled this earth, before he take down this earth, he gonna do something, Israel. Let's see what it is. This is John chapter 6. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 39. And it reads, "And this is the Father's will, which have sent me, that all of which he have given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day." But I thought our parents and our grandmothers and grandfathers and brothers and sisters were in heaven already. Read it again, K. Judah. "And this is the Father's will, which have sent me, that all of which he have given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day." Verse 40. "And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which said the Son and believe on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day." Jump down to verse 44. Verse 44, and it reads, "No man can come unto me except the Father which have sent me draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day." Jump down to verse 53. I hope you're getting the picture, Israel. Verse 53, and it reads, "Then Jesus said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, except ye eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, ye have no life in you." And our fathers was always thinking physical, never spiritual. He was talking about this word. You must eat this word, Israel. He wasn't talking about eating his flesh and drinking his blood. He was talking about eating this word. And also what we keep called Passover, when we eat the bread and drink the wine, which represent Christ suffering and him dying on a tree. Verse 54, and it reads, "Whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood have eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day." So nobody's in heaven right now. Nobody is in heaven right now. They are all still asleep in the grave. Don't believe me? Let's go to 1 Thessalonians. I let the Bible talk that talk, boy. I let the Bible talk that talk, Israel. This is 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Because Christ just say, "I'm going to raise you up at the last day." This is 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. First Thessalonians chapter 4, and I'm going to pick it up at verse 13. Christ say he's going to raise them up at the last day. Let's see when this is going to happen. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and I'm going to pick it up at verse 13, and it reads, "But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep." Then Christ say they are still in the grave. He will raise them up at the last day. "That ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord should not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself should descend from heaven with a shout," that's that last trumpet, "with the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord." He never said he was going to take you to heaven. As the Lord is coming down, we're going to meet him in the air, then we're coming right back down on the earth. This is the first resurrection. This is the first resurrection. Let's go to Revelation chapter 20. Revelation chapter 20. Revelation chapter 20. Because once Christ raised the dead and those in the first resurrection, let's see what he promised them. Revelation chapter 20. And I'm going to read two verses, verse 5 and verse 6. Revelations chapter 20. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 5. Revelations chapter 20. And I'm going to read verse 5. And it reads, "But the rest of the dead live not again until the 1,000 years was finished." See, this is Christ's kingdom. That's why I'm trying to show you the difference. In Christ's kingdom, he going to rule for 1,000 years. Then after the 1,000 years, which is called the 8th day, that represents the Father's kingdom. That new Jerusalem coming out of heaven, those pearly gates, the streets of gold, that's the Father's kingdom. Christ's kingdom will be on the earth for 1,000 years. Read verse 5 again, K. Judah. "But the rest of the dead live not again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he that have part in the first resurrection. On such the second death have no power, but they should be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Did you hear that, Israel? So those in the second death, understand this, those in the second death, they have no power. They should not be in the first resurrection. They got to come up in the second death. That's when the books going to be open. That's when the books are going to be open. And you're going to be judged, everyone, according to his deeds, according to your works. Hey, Krista, I see your question, sister. Nuh-uh. We're supposed to do it once a year on Passover. And that's where they mess up at. They have it every other Sunday. But Christ told us to remember his death. When? Around Passover. That's once a year. Around springtime. Around March, April. Around springtime. So no, we do not supposed to keep communion every other Sunday or every third Sunday. We're supposed to do it around Passover when we break bread and drink wine. So no, sister, the Christians, the way they do it is incorrect. All right, so this is what we're going to do. Let's go to 2 Peter chapter 3 again. 2 Peter chapter 3. I used to be confused too, Crystal, when I first came into the truth and I saw how they was keeping communion every other Sunday, every third Sunday. I was like, hold up. Christ said to remember this on around Passover. So that goes to show you that they're not reading the Bible. They just doing their own thing. That's why the Bible say they go about to establish their own righteousness. And that's what they doing. They not reading this Bible, Crystal. Because if they reading this Bible, they going to do what thus said the Lord, not what thus said the preacher. I feel you, Yosha. That, hey, that is good you out the church. That is great you out the church. So now you don't got to be deceived or lied to no more like I was. And Crystal and all our people. To be honest with you, this whole world, man, this whole world has been deceived. Whether you're a Gentile, an Israelite, Ham, African, it don't matter who you are on this earth. We all have been deceived. Satan has deceived this whole earth, man. Let's go to 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3. And I'm going to read verse 8 again. Because I hope y'all understand so far what the Bible been breaking down. Not K. Judah, but the Bible been breaking down. That Christ is showing you that he going to rule this earth for 1,000 years. Lovely T81 in the building, y'all. Lovely T81 in the building. Lovely T talk about I'm late. It's all good, sus. This is 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 8, and it reads, "But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day." So when Christ rules this earth, to us, it's going to literally be 1,000 years. But to Christ, it's just going to be as one day. Because Christ don't run off of time. We do. Now let's go to Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4, because y'all remember in Revelations, when I just read in Revelation chapter 20 verse 6, it said that those in the second death, it have no power. Those are the people, Israel, that have to stand before the judgment seat. That's scary. I don't want to be one of them. That's why I'm trying to get this thing right now. I don't want to stand in that long line. I want to be in the first resurrection. of the first resurrection. And that's why I'm doing everything in my power to get this word out. And many other brothers and sisters. This is Hebrews chapter 4. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. Hebrews chapter 4. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. Now remember, the Bible said that those in the second death, let's see what Christ told our forefathers. They were so evil and wicked that he told them something that scared me to death. And I'm not playing. After I read this, Israel, this scared me to death because I do not want to be one of these people. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 4. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. Watch this, Israel. Listen to this. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 1. And it reads, "Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, and of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them." Who was to them? When Christ brought our forefathers out of the wilderness, he told them to keep my commandments and do my will. That's it. Keep my commandments, hearken to my voice, and do as I tell you to do. And it should go good with you, Israel. But they did not listen. So let's see what he told them. "For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it," because they didn't have no faith. Verse 3. "For we which have believed do enter into rest, as he said, as I have sworn in my wrath, if they should enter into my rest, although the works was finished from the foundation of the world. For he spake in a certain place on the seventh day on this wise, and God did rest the seventh day from all his works. And in this place again, if they should enter into my rest, seeing therefore it remaineth that some must enter therein. And they to whom it was first preached enter not in because of unbelief." Did you hear that? Because our fathers did not believe in Christ, he told them they should not be in the first resurrection. That is scary, man. That is scary. Let me continue read. Verse 7. "Again, he limited a certain day, saying in David, today, after so long a time, as it is said, today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts. For if Jesus have given them rest, then would he not after have spoken of another day?" What day is Paul referring to? That 1,000 years of peace. Verse 9. "There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God. For he that is entered into his rest is also seized from his own works, as God did from his. Let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same examples of unbelief." Christ told our forefathers from 20 years old and upward, they all died in the wilderness, Israel. And he told them, "I have sworn in my wrath, you should not enter into my rest," meaning you should not be in the first resurrection. And if that is not scary, I don't know what else is. That is scary. That they got to wait a full 1,000 years. Then they got to come up when the books are open. And they're going to be judged, every man according to their works. That scares me. And that's why I'm trying to get this thing right now, so I don't have to stand in judgment. If you be in the first resurrection, you don't have to stand in judgment. You done made the homecoming. You good. You a spirit being, just like Christ and the Father and the angels. Let's go to Psalms 95. Psalms 95. The book of Psalms 95. Where did Paul quote this from? Let's go to Psalms 95. He told our fathers, you would not be in the first resurrection. Why? Let's see. This is Psalms 95. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 8. Psalms 95, and I'm going to pick it up at verse 8, and it reads, "Harden not your hearts, as in the provocation, when you provoke me, Israel, as in the day of temptation in the wilderness, when your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my work. 40 years long was I agreed with this generation and said, it is a people that do err in their heart, and they have not known my ways, unto whom I swear my wrath, that they should not enter into my rest. And that is scary, man. That is scary. Let's go to Isaiah 65. Let me show you the difference from Christ's kingdom and the Father's kingdom. Because in Christ's kingdom, it's still going to be flesh and blood people on the earth. How we know that? Let's go to Isaiah 65. You're going to have spirit beings, and you're going to have flesh and blood people in Christ's kingdom. But in the Father's kingdom, everybody will be spirit beings. This is Isaiah 65. How we know it's still going to be flesh and blood people in Christ's kingdom? Let's read it. God is not a vain God, Israel. He put all this in his Bible because he wants us to read it. So let's read it. How we know that in Christ's kingdom, it's still going to be flesh and blood people. Let's read it. This is Isaiah 65, the book of Isaiah 65. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 19. And it reads, "And I will rejoice in Jerusalem and joy in my people, and the voice of weeping shall be no more heard in her, nor the voice of crying. There should be no more thence an infant of days." Read it again, K. Judah. "There should be no more thence an infant of days, nor an old man that hath not filled his days. For the child shall die at 100 years old." That's how you know it's still going to be flesh and blood people in Christ's kingdom. How shall a child die at 100 years old? Meaning Christ going to put long life back on the table. You're going to be 100 looking like a child. You're going to be 100 years old looking like a young man, looking like a young woman. Let me read that again. "There should be no more deaths in infant of days, nor an old man that have not filled his days. For the child should die at 100 years old, but the sinner being 100 years old should be a curse." So Christ is going to put long life back on the table during 1,000 years reign. Meaning he's going to give you more time to get it right. Understand that, Israel. Now let's go to Zechariah chapter 8. Zechariah chapter 8. Let me show you something else about Christ's kingdom. Zechariah chapter 8. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 4. Zechariah chapter 8. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 4. And it reads, "Thus said the Lord of hosts, there should yet old men and old women dwell in the streets of Jerusalem, and every man with his staff in his hand for very age." That's how you know this is talking about flesh and blood people. Because what do a man and a woman who's a spirit being need a staff for? You don't need no staff when you're a spirit being. You can't die no more. You're not going to weep no more. You have made the homecoming. So this is talking about Christ's kingdom, not the Father's kingdom. Because in the Father's kingdom, it won't be no more flesh and blood. Everybody will be spirit beings. But in Christ's kingdom, you're going to have spirit beings, those in the first resurrection, and flesh and blood people. They still going to be having children in Christ's kingdom. Verse 4 again. "Thus said the Lord of hosts, there shall yet old men and old women dwell in the streets of Jerusalem, and every man with his staff in his hand for very age. And the streets of the city shall be full of boys and girls playing in the streets thereof." This is Christ's kingdom. Understand that, Israel. Now let's go back to Revelation chapter 20. Because y'all remember when Christ told you in Psalms 95 that they should not enter into his rest, meaning 1,000 years of peace. Let's see about the second death, the one I told you that scared me to death. This is Revelation chapter 20. Revelation chapter 20. And I'm going to pick it back up at verse 5 again. Revelation chapter 20. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 5. Revelation chapter 20. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 5. And it reads, "But the rest of the dead live not again until 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he that have part in the first resurrection. On such the second death have no power. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Now jump down to verse 12. Verse 12, and it reads, "And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were open, and another book was open, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which was written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." Israel, I want to tell you, my people, Gentiles, whoever listening, worldwide, get it together, man. Do not get yourself cast into a lake of fire. That is forever. Now, if you big and bad and you think you can handle it, do your thing. Barbecue chicken. I'm not going there. I'm not playing with this word. I'm not going there. So if you think you big and bad and you could be barbecued forever, do your thing. But you won't find me doing it with you, partner. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. "Because after Christ have put down all rule," let's see what he's going to do. Christ has to put all enemies under his feet. And let's see after he do that, what he's going to do. After everything is accomplished, after everybody's in the first resurrection, everybody been judged, everybody in the lake of fire, what is Christ going to do? Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And I'm going to let the Bible tell you. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 24. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 24. "Then cometh the end, when he should have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, which he should have put down all rule and authority and power. For he must reign till he have put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that should be destroyed is death." See, it won't be no more death in the Father's kingdom. But in Christ's kingdom, it's still going to be flesh and blood. Verse 27. "For he have put all things under his feet. But when he said all things are put under him, it is manifested that he is expected, which did put all things under him." Talking about the Father. Verse 28. "And when all things should be subdued unto him, then should the Son also himself be subject unto him that put all things under him, that God may be all in all." Then Christ is going to deliver up the kingdom to the Father. But we got to get understanding also of the Father's kingdom. Let's go to John chapter 14. John chapter 14. Book of John chapter 14. This is the book of John chapter 14. And I'm going to read verse 2 and 3. The book of John chapter 14. "After Christ have put down all rule, all authority, he going to deliver up the kingdom to the Father. But in the Father's kingdom, we must see what is inside the Father's kingdom that's different than Christ's kingdom." Let's read it. This is John chapter 14, and I'm going to pick it up at verse 2. And it reads, "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also." When Christ say he's going to go and prepare a place, where? Inside the Father's kingdom, Israel. That's why I'm telling you, Christ's kingdom and the Father's kingdom are different. Because in the Father's kingdom, it's that streets of gold that we always read about. That transparent glass, those pearly gates. That's the Father's kingdom. That New Jerusalem coming out of heaven. In Christ's kingdom, there would still be flesh and blood. In the Father's kingdom, there would be no more flesh and blood. Now let's go to Luke 22. Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22. Christ told his disciples something. Let's see what it is, Israel. This is Luke 22. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 15. Luke 22. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 15. And it reads, "And he said unto them, with desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I would not any more eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Read it again, K. Judah. "For I say unto you, I would not any more eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God." This is the Father's kingdom. Verse 17. "And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I would not drink of the fruit of this vine until the kingdom of God shall come." What kingdom is this? Let's go to Leviticus 23. Then we're going to see what kingdom is he talking about. Let's go to Leviticus chapter 23. Christ said he would not take of the Passover anymore until it be fulfilled in his Father's kingdom. Let's go to Leviticus chapter 23. Then we're going to go to the last scripture. I got one more scripture after this, and that's it, Israel. One more scripture after this, and that's it. Leviticus chapter 23. What kingdom is Christ referring to? This is the book of Leviticus chapter 23. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. Leviticus chapter 23. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. And it reads, "And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them, concerning the feast of the Lord." No, the feast of the Jews. "Concerning the feast of the Lord." So these are the Lord's feasts, not the Jews' feasts, "which you should proclaim to be holy convocations. Even these are my feasts. 6 days shall work be done, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of rest and holy convocation. Ye should do no work therein. It is the Sabbath of the Lord in all your dwellings. These are the feasts of the Lord, even holy convocation, which you should proclaim in their seasons, in the 14th day of the first month at evening," meaning at evening, because God created his days, evening and morning make a day, not 12 or 1. In the 14th, verse 5, "In the 14th day of the first month at evening is the Lord's Passover. And on the 15th day of the same month is the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Unto the Lord, 7 days ye must eat unleavened bread." How long did God give man on this earth? 7,000 years. 1 day is to the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is 1 day. God created everything in 6 days. 6,000 years. 1,000 years for each day. Understand that, Israel. To us, 1,000 years. To the Lord, 1 day. That's why he said he created everything in 6 days. 6,000 years. So how long did he give man up on the earth? 7,000 years to get it right. After that, it is finished. That's why we got the weekly Sabbath day. He gave man 6 days to work. And on the 7 days, a Sabbath of rest. How long Christ going to rule this earth? For 1,000 years. On what day? The 7th day. I hope you understand it. Verse 7. "In the first day, you should have a holy convocation. You should do no servile work therein," meaning you don't supposed to go to your job on the first day and on the last day. Verse 8. "But you should offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. 7 days. In the 7th day is in holy convocation. You should do no servile work therein." So the first day of the feast, you don't supposed to do no servile work. And on the last day of the feast, you don't supposed to do no servile work. Understand that, Israel. Now jump down. Jump down to verse 33. Now we need to understand this 8th day when the Father's kingdom come down. This is verse 33. And it reads, "And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, the 15th day of the 7th month should be the Feast of Tabernacles, for 7 days unto the Lord. on the first day should be a holy convocation. You should do no servile work therein. 7 days, you should 7 days, you should offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. On the eighth day, read it again, K. Judah. On the eighth day, read it again, K. Judah. On the eighth day should be in holy convocation unto you, and you should offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. It is a solemn assembly, and ye should do no servile work therein. The eighth day, y'all, is when the Father's kingdom come down. That's what the eighth day represent. Why? Because God gave man 7,000 years to get it right. And on the eighth day is something new. We will all be spirit beings. Now let's go to the last scripture. Christ say that he would not drink of the fruit of the vine until it be fulfilled in his Father's kingdom. Let's go to Revelations 21. Revelations. And this will be last. Revelations chapter 21. And this will be last. I pray somebody got some understanding. I pray that these lessons are helping you in your walk. And all I'm asking you to do, Israel, and whoever else listen, Gentiles, Israel, whoever want this truth, that's all I'm asking you to do. Do not give up. Endure until the end. Endure until the end, family. Do not give up. Endure until the end. So you can receive your crown. Revelations 21. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. Revelations 21. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. This is Revelations 21. And I'm going to pick it up at verse 1. This is the kingdom that Christ is referring to. Verse 1. And it reads, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them." This is talking about the Father, y'all. "And he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. And God himself," not talking about Christ, "God himself shall be with them and be their God." Why? Because this is the time, the eighth day, where there will be no more flesh and blood. Because the Father is a spirit. He don't dwell with flesh and blood. Verse 4, "And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death." See, if it's not going to be no more death, what everybody has to be? Spirit beings. "Neither sorrow, nor crying, neither should there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away." Now jump down to verse 10. Verse 10. Jump down to verse 10. And it reads, "And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain, and showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God, having the glory of God, and her light was like unto a stone most precious, even like a jasper stone, clear as crystal." Verse 12, "And he had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and names written thereon, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel." And your brother K. Judah want to say to my family, to all those who listen, and I appreciate everybody who listened to your brother K. Judah, because I do this for you, to save myself and to teach you how to save yourself. And your brother K. Judah want to say, shalom.
No way I forget what you done. Get what you done for my people. I won't forget what you done for me. Get what you done, my King. Oh, I won't forget what you done. Get what you done for my people. people. I won't forget what you've done for me. Forget what you've done, my king.
That's been a terrible.
Now I feel fine. More while you water. Now I can't fly. Flow in the water. You could take a dive. Flow in the flow. Going four at a time. All in the world. All in the sky. All in the water. Power resides with my king. Yeah, yeah. He's mighty. Whoa, there's no way I forget what you done. Get what you done for my people. I won't forget what you done for me. Get what you done, my king. Oh, I won't forget what you done. Get what you done for my people. I won't forget what you done for me. Get what you done, my king. Yeah. 20 and 4, my king. 20 and 4, my king. I was a day I'll be pressing him on, my king. I could be more than this. I try to be more like you. I try to be more like this. Keeps coming back to you. I gotta know your face, gotta know your truth. Try to be more than me. Yeah, it's supernatural healing I'm feeling, getting close now. And there's no way I forget what you done. Get what you done for my people. I won't forget what you done for me. Get what you done, my king. Oh, I won't forget what you done. Get what you done for my people. I won't forget what you done for me. Get what you done, my king. Yeah. Nah, nah, ooh, 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 ooh. Nah, nah, ooh, 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 ooh. Nah, nah, ooh, 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 ooh. Nah, nah, ooh, ooh. And there's no way I forget what you done. Get what you done for my people. Get what you done for me. Get what you done, my king. Get what you done. Get what you done for my people. Get what you done for me. Get what you done, my king.
Cursed be the ground. For our sake. Both thorns and thistles it shall bring forth. For us. For out of the ground we were taken, for the dust we are. And to the dust we shall return.